person and involving yourself is a expected thing from a teacher, right? Sooner or later you should do it, not for me, not for you, but for our, you know, the people for whom we are working here is our future of the country, that is students. So you should come forward and contribute and involve. Okay, anything else? Otherwise I'll go ahead.
Okay,
I'll continue. Okay, so I have given one example. I'm not going to read one, the vision and mission statements. Any university you just Google, you just click MIT US, you will find in any university there is one vision, great statement. And that is always the dream line, dream statement of any organization. I have read one statement which is written, which is, you know, pasted in the rector's office. I have seen that there is one line that you want to be a good technological university doing some good thing in the research and scientific knowledge delivery, right? So you have to set your vision in the department as well as in the institute. But department vision must be connected to the institute vision. You cannot promise bigger than the institute. You can achieve bigger than the institute, but your promise must be connected with, your dream must be connected with the institute dream. And after that, mission statements may be 3 or 4 or 2. But vision statement generally, in your website, I'm sorry to say sir, in your website, mission statement is 3. I was going through the mission statement in TU, mission statements are 3, but there in your office, it is, I know that you have come here now, the things are going to change dynamically. So the vision statement I was seeing, these are 3 vision statements, which are there in your website. But vision is always a single line, big thing, which you dream about the university, which you dream about the organization. Then there comes mission statement. And after that, what are we done? To deliver quality academic programs, to attract and nurture quality minds, to inculcate strong research culture and dynamic, efficient and effective team of academic and supporting staff. These are the mission statements of the institute. Go down. What do you go down? Go to the program. Go to your department. For your department, write some statements, what do you want to achieve? And then there are some graduate attributes. Those attributes are to be kept in mind while writing the statements. What is this? Investigate, subject specialist, adaptable, effective communicator, ethically and socially aware, reflective learner, confident, respectful, responsible and resourceful. These are the terms. You might think that these are the common terms why you are talking about, but these are called as graduate attributes. The attributes, the characteristics which are required to be in your graduates. So you have to keep all these verbs, all these nouns and adjectives in your mind while writing your mission statements. Whether you are going to achieve something for the student, whether your students are going to be responsible citizen, whether your students are going to be effective communicator, whether your students are going to be good leaders, whether your students are going to be adaptive for the industry demands and industry requirements, that you have to see and you have to write your mission statements. That is about your program statements. And before I talk about outcomes, let me quickly talk about objectives. Again, I have copy paste is not allowed, but these objectives are not mine. These objectives I have taken from OBE. Therefore, I have copied, right? So students are competent, creative, highly valued professionals in industry, academia and government. Students are adaptable in the workplace. Students have good leadership and teamwork skills. Students, this is related to one program, electronics and communication engineering. Students act with global, ethical, societal, ecological and commercial awareness. These are the objectives of your program, objectives of your department. You write, this is your dream actually. These are not the outcomes, these are the actual objectives which you have written. Objectives are the statements that you are promising to your students. That is, electronics and communication engineering students are going to have all these things after the end of 6 years or 5 years. Once they complete 6 years, you have to check how much of these things they have achieved, and there are some methods to measure that, and that thing which is there in the change, as a change in the students, is actually the outcome. So what are outcomes? Again, I have written some 12 statements. And these statements are, again, OBE statements. I'm not saying don't just copy-paste these statements. These are the guidelines to write outcomes for your program. What is the first outcome a BED suggests? Students will have an ability to apply knowledge of mathematics, science and engineering. Students will have the ability to apply the knowledge of science, engineering and mathematics. Not only the students will have understanding of science, engineering and mathematics, but the student must have ability to apply the knowledge of science, engineering and mathematics. Is the first expected outcome. Anticipating, you are anticipating my student will have this. At the end of 6 years, my student will have this. Number two, an ability to design and conduct experiments as well as to analyze and interpret data. An ability to design a system, an ability to function in multidisciplinary team, multi-country, multidisciplinary team. Yesterday one student, I must appreciate one boy. He asked a so important question, a very, very important question. Sir, when we want to construct a team, you are talking about working in a team. Teamwork is a very important skill one is required to have. How to construct a committee? How to construct a team when we want to do something in a team? I said, how to select the members in a team? You have to understand, why do you form a team? You do not form a team where all the people have same expertise. You do not form a team. You form a team where you need one person from programming, you need one person from hardware, you need one person from market, you need one person who can arrange resources from outside, you know one person who can present your product very well, you have all different expertise, you combine, and that is how you form a team. And therefore, students are required to learn, required to work under multidisciplinary team, multidisciplinary culture, multidisciplinary nationalities. All these are required to be there in the students. That you are thinking, you are anticipating. I am not saying that all of this you are going to achieve. Who is saying? You just promise, you see a big dream. If 10-20% of your dream is achieved at the end of 6 years, your success is a great success. You promise that these 12 things will be changed in my students. There are 3 things in one student, your success is great. What is next? An ability to identify, formulate and solve engineering problems. An ability to communicate effectively. An ability to have lifelong learning. Lifelong learning. What is lifelong learning? Yesterday I was talking about, you must be always learning. And when you are in learning mode, you are always filled as a child. You will always think yourself as a child. You will always think yourself as a young learner. And what is the advantage? You will enjoy your life. What is second thing is, whenever you come across with new problem, you will have the ability to address that problem. You may not be able to address, you may not be able to solve the problem, but at least you will have some ability to think about that problem, how it could be solved. Fundamentally, that the students is supposed to have. Don't you think that your students need to have these things? I think everyone will agree that your students should have all these qualities at the end of 6 years, once the students complete their Bachelor of Engineering degree. So this is the promise which you make, and a knowledge of contemporary issues, knowledge of technical issues, modern engineering and engineering practice, and of course global and societal issues, issues related to environment, persons should not harm the environment in the name of development of technology, advancement of technology. That must be there in the student. These are the broad outcome statements. These guidelines you can use for your own program. You can write that mechanical engineering students will have an ability to, number one, to design and develop, you know, models of IC, whatever types of engines, cryogenic engines, and second, would be able to devise some simple, simplified models for these kind of engines. 5-6 different skills, 5-6 different outcomes you may write for your programs. And that is called as outcome. I'll give one example. I have written one course outcome. I talked about a program outcome that was related to electronics and communication engineering. Suppose there is a course like digital circuit design in electronics and communication engineering. How many outcomes are there in your program? There are 11 outcomes. There are 12 outcomes. All those outcomes, please understand, will not be achieved through a single course. Why do you offer a management subject to your student? Have you ever thought it? Why do you offer humanities course to your student? What is the requirement of civil engineering to be studied by electronics and communication engineering student? Do you think that? Why computer science person again studies physics? Why computer science and IT person again studies basic electrical engineering? Why? The purpose is to develop a set of skills. The purpose is to develop a set of objectives in the student. The purpose is to develop, the purpose to bring change in the students, which comprises of so many skill set in the students. And therefore, I am saying that your program comprises of many courses. Each course has its outcome. There will be some common outcomes among all the courses, between the courses, but there will be some different outcomes also. If you are teaching, how many of you are from Computer Science, IT and ECE? How many of you are? There are people from CSE, IT and ECE? I mean Electronics, Computer and IT, there are people from?
ECE, IT.
We have people from those branches. If you are teaching digital circuit design, are your students able to design a ROM? You teach them ROM is inside computer, and don't you think that it is difficult? It is not difficult at all. Simply using a breadboard and simple IC, they can develop 4 KB, 2 KB ROM and RAM. Students have attempted it. If they have not attempted, have you ever thought of it? Students can really do it? Yes, they can easily do it. That outcome you can write in a digital circuit design, that my students will be able to design a 4 kilobyte of ROM after completion of my course. Forget about 6 years. Your program has program is a combination of so many courses. This time you are teaching digital circuit. At the end of your course, what is your promise? Do you see any change in your students? What change? Is there a single student out of 80 students who is able to design some ROM? If it is, your success is the greatest success, I tell you. So, what is there, what I have written there, I think last line I have written that file. Design modular combinational circuits using encoders, decoders, multiplexers and demultiplexers. All you have taught theoretically. This is multiplexer. Multiplexer is used in television. There are so many channels which are coming, you press a button, you see one program. That's the example of multiplexing and demultiplexing. You have given example also. But are they able to design a simple, single RAM or ROM or multiplexer? If they are able to design in a breadboard, your job is done. Your course has got its outcome. What I am trying to say is that these are the outcomes associated in this particular course, digital logic design. All the courses which you are handling, all the courses which we are handling, every course has its outcome. If you combine all the 200, 300 outcomes, it will become 10 outcomes. Because many of the outcomes will be common in different courses. Communication skill will be common. Last semester I taught a course in MIIT, sensors and actuators. The students told me in the beginning, sir, we are told by our teacher that this is a theoretical course. So you will be talking much theory about this course. I said, yes, but do you know that it has got tremendous application? Do you know in smartphone how many sensors are there? I asked the questions, in your smartphone how many sensors are there? They say that, sir, we have this finger and we press the finger, it identifies. That is a sensor. I said, in all your smartphone, there are 22 sensors. I named all those 22 sensors. Their eyes were open. Oh, this is actually about the sensor course. Second, have you heard about driverless car of Google and the Nissan? They said, yes. How it is working? Just because of two technology. What is first technology? Sensors. Thousands of sensors they are using in driverless car. What is second? What is second, I asked them? Second is artificial intelligence. It means that every course has its outcome and every course has some unique outcome. So like I have given one example of this particular course. Assessment. How do we assess? Direct assessment methods are exams, assignments, tests, final year projects, laboratories, exit interviews. How many times when our students are exiting, when they are going out from our institute, how many times we have interviewed our students? Employer comes, they interview. How many times you have interviewed them? Come guys, I want to have interaction with you. How many times you have done? I am not asking formal interaction. How many times you have informal interaction? How many times you have asked and you have tried to know how many of them are communicating wonderfully? How many times you have tried that they are really able to deliver something? How many times you have tried they are really able to suggest a model for something? How many of times you have tried that they are really able to analyze something? You give a topic, okay, I am giving one topic to you, conventional energy to a mechanical guy. And you speak your good student,
Pali or Kuti student, ask him, can you talk on conventional energy sources or renewable sources of energy for 5 minutes? Watch him, watch her, what the guy is speaking. Observe. That's the outcome. I'm just talking about assessment method. So exit interview will also help you to assess whether there is any outcome in the student or not. Otherwise, it will look always theoretical, right? These are all theory things. But if you have some statistical model, if you can just note it down all the things which you are coming across with the students, it will be a wonderful work. I think engineering counseling will take input from you. If you really keep something documented and you do something innovative way, someday your engineering counseling will ask you, I mean, you give those assessment tools to me. We will float to all the technological universities. Believe me, it happens, right? And assignment, exam, how many times you have, everyone gives assignment. What type of assignment we give? Yesterday I was giving one example, if you have listened to me very carefully. I gave one assignment to the students. There were 60 topics in my sensors and 55 students were there. I assigned one topic to one student. There was another course I taught, signals and systems. 60 topics, 120 students were there. I selected one student from CSE, selected one student from ECE, made a team of two. What did I do? I gave them a topic as an assignment, 10 marks. I said, take this topic, prepare a presentation, something innovative, what is convolution? Prepare a topic, present among yourself, at your home, wherever you want to present, in front of Mandala Palace you want to present, present it. Open the laptop, present it, record it in your mobile phone, prepare a video lecture, send it to me. That was one option. Second, I said, present via Skype online. 17 students presented to me, 18 students presented to me via Skype online. Is this not the way we can do assignment? Lot of work we have to do. But for whom we are coming? I know that we all have responsibility for family and others. That is one thing. But we have greater responsibility for the great nation through students. So for whom we are here? So we have to be always ready, but tremendous amount of work if it requires for that particular thing. I tell you, that was so good where I could see my students, how some of them did wonderful. Some of them did just magnificent. I was so happy that these two girls were always silent in my class. Oh my God, how they have presented so nicely. They are not copying there. Otherwise, an assignment, what generally happens? You give the assignment, sir. Three students will note, another will take their copies and they will just copy and submit it to you. But is it not the innovative way you can think about? I'm suggesting one. There may be hundreds which may be in your mind. You are even, you know, greater and experienced teachers than me, some of you. Right? You may have many more innovative ideas, but is it not innovative idea? So if you think that nothing could be done, your assignment is just copy-paste, you are talking about outcome and assessment, how can we assess? Yeah, it's just rubbish talk. But if you think something differently, it's not rubbish. Right? So these are the tools by which you can assess your this thing. Indirect, industrial training, exit survey, course survey, employer survey, alumni survey. How many times you talk to the people who are working in different industries, those who are passed out from here? What they will tell, do you know that? Sir, the courses which were offered in your college, that is in our university, some of the courses were irrelevant. In one course, syllabus was irrelevant. We could learn great things from that course. That teacher was a great teacher. His delivery was great. Three labs were wonderful labs, which are helping us in industry. They will tell you the correct reflex, what you can do. If it is required, you will revise your syllabus. You will modify your vision and mission statement as well. That is there. Therefore, alumni survey. Alumni survey will tell you whether there is outcome in the student or not. Employer survey. Employers come to you, you think that training and placement officer is there in the technical university, technological university. This is job of the technical TPU only. He will talk to employer and he will ask what and how my students are doing. Being an electronics and communication engineering person, how many times I have tried to ask my employer, sir, how my students are doing in an industry? They will tell you the correct thing, whether your students are doing good there or not. they will tell you. That is actually the outcome. Many more things. Ask the parents what they are observing in their children after passing from this institute. Ask the parents, ask the alumni, ask the employers. There are many stakeholders you can ask them. What changes you observe in our students, they will tell you. And changes are nothing but outcomes. And it needs to be assessed, it needs to be measured, it needs to be mapped with objectives, which is called as mapping between the objective and outcomes. Right? Writing learning outcomes and linking them to teaching learning activities and to assessment is a process, not an event. It's a continued process, it's not an event. I tell you, suppose we decide, now we are interested to apply for accreditation. Myanmar Engineering Council. We are interested to apply for accreditation of AUI. What we will do? You will be given assignment, you have to complete your application in 4 months. What people will do? They will prepare all course outcomes and objectives for all the courses, they will prepare a lot of documentations and they will make it ready in 3 months. It's an event. But so much things we just make it and we manipulate it, we create it so that committee will come and committee will be happy. Everywhere it happens. But why to do it? You all are practicing this thing. Let us document it. Maybe soft form or hard form. Therefore, this outcome-based education is not an event. It's not one-day affair. It's a continuous process. If you practice this process, keep it documented, your outcomes are automatically assessed. You get the reflection, you will incorporate the feedback, and whatever change is required in your course, you will do automatically, no one will tell you. And after 5 years, you will say that my course has brought ripples and changes in my students. And I can tell you what changes are there in my students because of digital circuit, because of signal processing, because of network theory, or whatever subject you can say. So, I think this thing I have already explained. It starts from vision, goals, and objectives, and outcomes. Then it goes to measurement methods, goes to results, and goes to excellence. And finally, it goes to program improvements. I'm not saying that you are going to achieve all your outcomes. If you don't achieve your outcomes, who will say that you are not achieving your outcome? Who will say? Employer will be always honest. Employer will say that, sir, I recruited your 70 people last year. 60 people are hugely bad. They are very bad in communicating. They are not able to, talk to our customers. One customer is from Singapore, he is not able to communicate with us. See, you have to understand one thing. You have to now come out from this is a great culture and great language, everything is great here. But you have to understand one thing. The country is growing like anything. It has to work in multi-nationality and multi-environmental culture. Suppose you got one brilliant and big industry in Yangon or here, and your students are employed. Customers are there from different countries. Why do we think that the customers of the organization will be only in Myanmar? If the customers are in different countries, who will communicate? Your guys who are joining that organization, they will communicate. Your employer will say that your 3 boys are not even able to talk to the people of Singapore, to the people of US. Why I have recruited? I just saw their good technical knowledge, I recruited them. What they are telling to you? It means they are telling you the outcome, their communication skill is not good. This is how you can assess that this is where you need improvement. You will again revise something. You will request your faculty. We will change if something is required in me to make my students communicating better, and we'll bring changes. That is outcome-based education. These are the assessment tools. I think I promised you that in 1 hour I'll complete you. So I have 5 minutes. So I will not take much time. These are the different methods by which you can assess different things. Assessment methods may be active, collaborative, learner-centric, objective-driven. You can involve the students also. You can honestly ask your students whether whatever dream with which they joined PU, please be honest and tell me how much of your dream came true after 6 years. Some of them will be true. After passing 6 years, they will not get any fear from you. They will tell you honestly. Or they will tell some of the teachers who are close to them, they will tell the correct things. Sir, really we joined PU with great hope and great dream, but someone will say that I could not achieve anything. Someone will say that PU has just helped me in transforming my life, in transforming my career. You will ask, how much and what transformation you got from PU? They will tell you what are the things which they felt they changed here. data in the school and the university. So therefore, it is active, collaborative. You can involve many, many persons, many organizations to get your outcome assessed. Objective driven, you will always compare your outcome with objective. I told you what is objective and what is outcome. You will always check, you will always validate, you will always compare your outcome with objective, whether outcome is mapped with objective or not. For example, in digital circuit design or say other course, survey one, survey two, these are the papers in civil engineering. You wrote, my students will have ability to communicate. I wrote this objective in signals and sensors. My faculty, my friends were laughing at me. How you can improve communication skill of your students through sensors network? Your course is not English course. Your course is not management course. How you are going to improve your communication skill of your students? When I completed that assignment, then my friends appreciated, oh, this is what you plan to do. Yes. There are many activities which you can do in the subjects where people think that these subjects are purely theoretical. No any subject is theoretical in engineering. All the subjects have their own relevance. And therefore, we offer some management course to all the branches, all the majors. Why do we offer? So that a student will have some managerial skill. Why do we offer management course to all the programs? It is to develop some managerial skill in all students. That is one of the examples I am giving you. But do we compare, do we assess, do we check, do we evaluate, how much change is there? That is what is called as outcome. And it is to be systematic, and it has to be used some rubrics. These are some accreditation agencies, right? APET, AUM, and these are the things with which you can start. And initially you can start with this one, but I would suggest you go for this, but take guidelines from these two big agencies. The guidelines are wonderful. Guidelines are bigger. Guidelines are great. Keeping those guidelines in your mind, start writing outcomes. Start writing objectives of your program and your courses. Those who are heads of the department, they should bother about PEOs and POs, that is program educational objectives and outcomes. Those who are not in the part of administration but engaged in teaching, they can think of writing course outcomes. If I am teaching network theory, if I am teaching computer network, what are outcomes in my course? Can I have analytical skill as an outcome in my course? Can I have program communication skill in my course? You have to think and you have to write. Because you better know about your course, none else, no one else. The person who is handling the course is only knowing about that course, what outcomes you are expecting to be there in the student. Write those outcomes. But once you complete the course, whenever you finish the course, please assess whether you have seen something that this will bring changes in the student. Those changes are there or not. If changes are there, you promise 3 changes, 1 change is there, you got 33% of success. If there are 2, you got 67% of success in your course. This is what I plan to talk about. I mean, this could not be done in one lecture. It could be talked for 10 days. How to formulate objective, how to formulate outcome, department wise, course wise. This is a 10 days course, right? But I just thought of sharing one overview, that this is a framework which is called as outcome based framework, where the entire world is moving to. Entire world. Now the US and so many European countries are coming out with one rule, that these are the agreed, I think you might have read in the newspaper, this is called a self-awareness. These are the institutes where, or these are the accreditation agencies where, if your institute is not accredited, your student will not come to MIT and they cannot have MS program. Such things are going to come very soon in the next 2-3 years. If your students are not accredited, your TU is not accredited from certain agencies, your students cannot join some topmost institutes in the world. And therefore, this is becoming a requirement. Forget about the requirement, let us make it habit, let us make it journey, let us make it as a continuous process. It's again enjoyable experience. That's all, and let us be committed with the inspiring things, right? As I am, and I feel motivated. Today again I am feeling, even though yesterday I could find in the second session 90% of participation. First session participation, active participation was around 60. Second, it increased to 90. But this morning again I observed, even I've started since morning, we're all active and energetic. The only, you know, the active participation is 80%. I cannot name any person who is not taking part, but I know who are not taking part. That should be quality in you, that who are not taking part, you must be. I mean, we all are teachers. I don't want to name anyone. I don't want to say that you stand up, right? I don't want to, point out anyone. But you, everyone know that who is not participating and who is participating. The persons who feel its importance, the persons who think that this is important, they will definitely participate. Others will simply, you know, attend. Okay, we'll come and just go, you know, for one day we will smile for this professor. That's all. So that's all from my side. Let us, dedicate this lecture to this inspiring equation. Motivation remains always constant for everyone. You know, someone were participating actually, actively, someone were simply sitting idle, that is idly, right? So it all depends, your excellence depends on commitment. So let us be committed for, that is towards the journey, outcome-based education. Yesterday I was talking about excellence. Excellence is not a full stop. Excellence is a process. Excellence is a journey. Success is a stop. You may get 100 times success in your life, but excellence is a journey. Let us, enjoy that journey successfully, happily, and let us have this attitude in us that will help us to achieve and to reach towards the excellence. That's all from my side. Thank you so much. If you have some doubts, I'll be happy to answer.